Do they all have names?
Sally, one through a million, probably. But yeah, they're really mellow. I don't think
they are mellow.
Most people would not. I don't know how many people would be comfortable standing next to their hive, but yeah, we got lucky. So.
I'd say my heart rate's up a little bit.
Hi everyone, I'm Ashley Swansong, host of Modern Gardener.
And I'm Mary Beth Janerick, the Community Education Director for Wasatch Community Gardens.
And this year, Mary Beth and I are very excited to bring to you Wasatch Community Gardens' annual urban garden and farm tour. We meet local gardening enthusiasts who have spent countless hours developing their beautiful garden.
That's right. And not only will we show you around these specially selected gardens, but we'll also be sharing some great insights, tips, and inspiration to help you in case you'd like to apply those in your own garden.
So let's go.
Is this the one the bumblebee was sleeping in?
Today we're at the home of Misty and Alan, whose yard is not only a wonderland for their kids, but home to many pollinators as well. Over the years, Misty and Alan have gotten a lot of inspiration from the Urban Garden and Farm Tour, and they're always finding ways to expand their garden space. Let's join Mary Beth as she finds out a little more about their playful yet functional garden.
This looks like you're feeding squirrels.
I know.
I know. I hate them. I love them. It's a struggle.
You've actually got food out. Is that designed for squirrels?
Hi, Misty and Alan. You guys have created such an amazing space here in your backyard.
When we moved here 10 years ago, it was covered in really thick bushes and bizarre grass. And so we've changed the path layout. We've added a lot of mulch for the kids. We've added the garden beds, and we think it fits better for what it for the size that it is.
Yeah, this is a really nice, soft landing zone, I guess, under the jungle gym.
So the local scapes classes that you can take, one of the teachers mentioned that falling from a play structure on mulch is way better on kids' bones than hard grass. So.
Or grown-up bones.
Right, so we're just trying to avoid the breakage here.
And not only do you have the fun toys for the kids, but you also have a garden back here.
We do.
So let's go look at some of the elements that you have in your garden. So Misty, explain to the viewers what is up with this tiny little tomato plant that's full of fruit.
So micro dwarf, it will not get any bigger. They grow that way. So we wanted to give some more sun exposure to the plants behind. So we thought of just planting some shorter things. So we've got lettuce and these tiny tomato plants. But yeah, that's how they grow.
These are just so awesome and they're full of fruit already.
Misty and Alan grow plenty of fruits, vegetables, and even have a bed dedicated to herbs. But their garden isn't just for growing food. It's a place for the family to come together. Gardening with kids can be a challenge, so Misty and Alan try to make it as easy as possible for their young ones to participate.
How did the kids help with this area of the garden?
So to get them involved, we actually let them pick seeds when we go to the store. This section of the yard doesn't get as much sun, so we actually plant flowers from seeds. The kids and I planted zinnias and cosmos, sweet peas, and we even tucked in some pickling cucumbers in here. They have their own tools, they have their own gloves, so we just try to let them have what they need to do it and then let them go at it.
So here I've got carrots, radishes, and garlic, I think.
And then I've got a lemon boy, some beans, tomatoes, raspberries. Down there are some strawberries and red and orange tomatoes.
What a great way to involve them in this amazing backyard project. I know you have a big garden in your front too. You seem to use every inch of space you have. So let's go take a look.
Even in the tiny spaces along the driveway, we try to add colors.
The flowers they plant also attract pollinators. One of their favorite pollinators is the monarch butterfly.
Misty, could you tell us a little bit about your work with monarch butterflies?
We have a registered monarch way station.
A registered monarch way station?
Yes, which means we provide food sources, nectar sources, and sort of other things in a habitat that would help them on their migration journey.
Can you explain why it's important to support the monarchs?
So in our research, we discovered that a huge percentage of their food source has been completely decimated. So they just don't have access to what they need in order to migrate. So we just thought any little bit that we can do, even if our space is so small, it will help.
Misty and Alan grow milkweed, an important food source for monarch caterpillars and butterflies.
The monarchs, when they find milkweed, they'll come and they'll lay their eggs, and then the baby caterpillars, the eggs are they're just so tiny. They're little white eggs, and to watch them grow just by eating this plant is fascinating. They grow so fast, and they're beautiful. I had no idea how big they were until we did the process last year, because you can see a picture, but you don't realize that they're huge. And they're beautiful.
That's so great. I know that the monarch butterflies aren't the only pollinators that you support here in your yard. So let's go take a look at some of the other things that you have going on.
Sure.
Misty and Alan also try to make their garden habitable for native bees.
It looks like you have a huge neighborhood here.
Utah is home to over 900 native bee species. A lot of them build their nests tunneling in the ground, but many live in boxes like the ones Misty and her family build.
So they use the straws, and these are paper straws, and we build the boxes a certain depth so that they can include female eggs. But they use the straws to place resources for their eggs in different sections throughout the tube. So it's like resources, eggs, and then they close them up, and then in fall, we'll put them in a dark place, and then in spring, we'll have new bees.
In this structure, it looks like some of the tubes have been used. Do you know what kind of bee has used this structure, and what other bees do you see?
So the ones that are dark are the ones that have been used and filled. So this particular bee looks like it might be a leaf cutter because they left some green material.
And they're not all the size of a bumblebee, right?
There's just so many. We have so many native bees in Utah. And some of them are like have a metallic sheen, like green. And we've even seen the tiny, tiny sweat bees, and they're really cute because they're so small. It's really fun to just know a few, see them, plant the plants that they like, and hope that they keep visiting.
In addition to nests, bees need food sources. Misty and Alan have lots of plants for bees, but see the most bees on their cone flowers, bee balms, and sunflowers. These flowering plants have also been great for their honeybees, which they started keeping earlier this year.
Alan, how did you guys get interested in beekeeping?
So we went on one of the Wasatch Community Gardens garden tours a couple years back and saw other people having beehives and raising bees, and it's just fascinating, and the kids love it.
You guys certainly seem like responsible beekeepers, and that's really important for folks that want to get into this to understand. You can't just start getting all your supplies without that understanding first.
Correct. I actually took classes for probably a year and a half and became a member of the Wasatch Beekeepers Association before we even got our bees.
There's just a ton of resources online and in the community.
And they're free.
How does keeping honeybees work with having kids?
Our kids have their own tiny little suits. Oh. And they love coming over and helping with inspections and operating the little smoker box.
I'm normally the smoker.
The bee smoker.
It's like a science experiment.
It is. It's like your whole yard is a giant science experiment. It's awesome.
Misty and Alan recently got a plot at the Sugar House Community Garden. It was a great way to safely spend time outside of the house during the pandemic. They also love to volunteer. They've helped create multiple free little libraries and recently built a mobile one.
So there is a global movement of book sharing boxes that we call little free libraries. And we've had a stationary one for 5 years, and my goal was always to try to figure out how to expand my reach with books in a way that worked with my family.
And do you guys like hop on your trike and?
We take it to the Sugar House Community Garden.
So when you're going there to work on your plot, you'll mm-hmm. bring your
we've
trike
brought
there?
We've plants and... in the box.
Oh my goodness. I mean, that way to connect with the community is just so incredibly special. And we also have some structures back here that I understand you are building to put at the Wasatch Community Gardens campus. So what are these two structures going to be?
So this is a soon-to-be Little Free Library and matching pantry. So people can bring food, share food, produce from the garden, and we think it's just going to be a really fabulous way for the community to connect down there.
Thank you, Alan and Misty, and you guys for having us here in your garden today and sharing how you garden together as a family.
Thank you for joining us for this episode of Wasatch Community Gardens Urban Garden and Farm Tour. Please subscribe to Modern Gardener and give us a thumbs up.
We hope that this tour has really expanded the way you think about gardening and has inspired you to create the garden of your dreams. Follow Wasatch Community Gardens on social media or visit our website to learn more about our workshops and webinars. And if you have any questions about the topics that we've covered today, feel free to email me.
Yeah, Mary Beth has a wealth of knowledge. And if you want to know more about today's particular tour, visit our blog.
Sorry, guys. Just go back to sleep. Go back to work,
or work.
Say.
Yeah, they work all day. They sleep at night.
Thanks, guys. Peace out.